Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. We will commence proceedings now. Welcome to the Tamil Senior Citizens Association Incorporated. We will commence today's proceedings with the traditional lighting of the lamp. In so announcing, I welcome the various dignitaries we have here today, and I ask you to come up to the stage to assist in the lighting, the traditional lighting of the lamp. His Excellency S. Skandakumar, High Commissioner for Sri Lanka in Australia. The Honourable Jodie McKay, MP for Stratfield. The Honourable Julia Finn, MP for Granville. Councillor Sung Ok, Mayor of Stratfield. Councillor John Burwood, Mr. Lal Wickramatunga, Council General, Councillor Raj Dutta. And I invite Mr. and Mrs. Suntheralingam to assist in the proceedings. National Anthem, I call Miss Kanmani Jagendran.
Let us all combine to advance.
For that wonderful salute to this beautiful country of ours with the Australian National Anthem. I would now ask you to take your seats.
Tamil Mootha Pelasikal Sangathin, 25 Vellivila Kana Vandirukkum, Ungal Anaivarukkum, Anbu Vanakkangal, Enadhu Peyar Thambi Raja Prabhakaran. பிரிஜாந்தி அவர்கள் ஆங்கிலத்தில் தொகுத்து வழங்க நிகழ்ச்சிகளை நான் தமிழில் தொகுத்து வழங்கவிருக்கின்றேன். இன்றைக்கு 25 வருடங்களுக்கு முன்னர் ஆரம்பிக்கப்பட்ட இந்த நியூ சவுத் வேல்ஸ் தமிழ் மூத்த பிறைகள் சங்கம் 27 அங்கத்தவர்களுடன் ஆரம்பிக்கப்பட்டு இன்று 860 அங்கத்தவர்களை தாங்கி நிற்கின்றது. இந்த சங்கம் மென்மேலும் வளர வேண்டும், இந்த வெள்ளி விழா கொண்டாட்டம் நல்ல முறையில் நிறைவு பெற வேண்டும் என்று ஆண்டவரையும் உங்களின் ஒத்துழைப்புகளையும் வேண்டிக்கொண்டு நிகழ்ச்சியை ஆரம்பிப்போம். ஆஸ்திரேலிய நேஷனல் அந்தத்தை தொடர்ந்து தமிழ் வாழ்த்து பாடவிருக்கின்றார் மிஸ்டர் பாலா திருநாவுக்கரசு.
வாழ்க தமிழ் மொழி, வாழிய வாழியவே, வானமணந்த அனைத்து மணந்திடும் வன்மொழி வாழியவே. எல் கடல் வைப்பினும் தன் மனம் வீசே இசை கொண்டு வாழியவே. எங்கள் தமிழ் மொழி, எங்கள் தமிழ் மொழி என்றென்றும் வாழியவே. சூழ்களி நீங்க தமிழ் மொழியோங்க துலங்குக மையகமே. தொல்லை வினைதர் தொல்லை வளர்மொழி
You to today's proceedings, I call upon the President of the Tamil Senior Citizens Association, Mr. Suntheralingam.
Your Excellency, Somasundaram Skandakumar, the High Commissioner for Sri Lanka. Honourable Jody McKay, Member of Parliament for Stratfield. Honourable Julia Finn, Member of Parliament for Granville. Your Worship, the Mayor of Burwood, John Baker, Councillor Mr. Raj Datta, Mr. Lal Vikramatunga, Consul General, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. I consider it my life-honored privilege to stand here before this distinguished audience and welcome you all on this historic occasion. It is with a sense of gratitude that I state that two members of our community, they being late Mr. Sagaram and Mr. S. Srinadiraja, whom we are fortunate to have with us today, pioneered to set up this association for the welfare of those who had entered this country, leaving their country of birth in search of peace and tranquility for them and their children. On the 25th of July, 1991, 27 members of the community formed together and formed the Tamil Senior Citizens Association and had their first meeting at Carrington Church in Stratfield. I am proud to say that in 25 years, the association has grown from 27 members to 860 members today. The unstinted devotion and commitment of the Tamil senior citizens of the association, the long line of presidents and their executive committee members, who work hard with devotion and dedication, led to our association grow from strength to what it is today. 2 years after the formation of the Tamil Senior Citizens Association, in the year 1993, our association established the Benevolent Society, which has today a membership of 662 members. The purpose of this society is to meet the funeral expenses on the deaths of its members. To date, 200 members have departed us, and $60,000 have been paid out as death benefits. The association took the initiative to form a housing cooperative for members of the association. In 1998, the Council on Aging, New South Wales, presented an award for good practice to our association for playing a supportive role for the Tamil community. In the year 2010, the New South Wales government presented our association the Seniors Achievement Award for Community Service. Our association has forged ahead with a clear vision for our members. For the last 28 years, our members have been meeting weekly on Thursdays at the Stratfield Council Community Center, which is situated at Bay Street. We are very grateful to Stratfield Council for having allowed us to use these premises for the last 25 years without a fee. Among the many objects of the association, the important objects are to remain non-party political and aim to maintain cordial and friendly relations with other ethnic communities in Australia. Our association, with such a glorious past, is proud to celebrate its 20th anniversary this year. The growth from small beginnings in 1991 to a strong membership today reflects the commitment and dedication of our members and the love and understanding shown to us by this beautiful multicultural country, Australia. Your Excellency, we are proud to have one of our own as the chief guest on this historic occasion. You are a person with noble attributes who has made and is still making immense contributions to the well-being of our community. This prompted us to invite you as the chief guest on this historic occasion. You are the head of the project called Urupane in the north of Sri Lanka, which works towards providing nutritional food to 33,000 school children daily in the war-affected areas in Vanni. In addition to this, you are also assisting in the education of children who are short of hearing in the war-ravaged areas. I have a duty as president of the Tamil Senior Citizens Association to bring to your attention some concerns of our membership. Our members are saddened by the numerous problems faced by our brethren in Sri Lanka in the war-affected areas. Several issues in relation to land, land ownership, resettlement of the displaced people, army occupation in the north, depriving of the fishing communities of their fishing rights, long detention of prisoners without legal proceedings being instituted, and many other issues left unresolved has led to a lot of mistrust and pessimism regarding this future, their future. These are issues that emerged as a result of the long drawn out civil war in the country for nearly 30 years. We are all aware that these problems cannot be resolved overnight. However, we believe that very genuine and concerted efforts will be made to resolve these issues as early as possible to give relief to our brothers and sisters in Sri Lanka, particularly in the north and east. We therefore appeal to you, Your Excellency, to use your good offices to bring to the notice of your government the concern of the Tamils in Australia with regard to these issues and to expedite the resolving of the issues without much delay. எமது மூத்த பிரஜைகள் சங்கத்தின் வெள்ளி விழா கொண்டாட்டத்தில் கலந்து சிறப்பிக்க வந்திருக்கும் உங்கள் அனைவருக்கும் சங்கத்தின் சார்பில் எனது அன்பான வணக்கத்தை தெரிவித்துக் கொள்கிறேன். 1991 ஆண்டு 27 அங்கத்தவர்களுடன் ஸ்தாபிக்கப்பட்ட எமது சங்கம் இன்று ஆல விருட்சம் போல் பறந்து வளர்ந்து 860 அங்கத்தவர்களுடன் வெற்றி நடை போட்டு 22 ஆண்டினை நிறைவு செய்துள்ளது. எமது வெள்ளி விழா கொண்டாட்டத்தினை சிறப்பிக்க வந்திருக்கும் பிரதம அதிதி திரு ஸ்கந்தகுமார் அவர்களே மற்றும் பேர்வுட் நகரபிதா ஜான் பேக்கர் அவர்களே, ஸ்ட்ரத்ஃபீல்ட் பாராளுமன்ற உறுப்பினர் ஜோடி மெக்கே, கிரென்வில் பாராளுமன்ற உறுப்பினர் ஜூலியா ஃபின், கவுன்சல் ஜெனரல் லால் விக்ரமதுங்க, கவுன்சிலர் ராஜ் டட்டா அவர்களே, உங்கள் வரவால் எமது சங்கம் மிகவும் பெருமை அடைகின்றது. மேன்மதங்கிய உயர்சானிகர் திரு சோமசுந்தரம் ஸ்கந்தகுமார் அவர்களே, தமிழராகிய நீங்கள் எமது நாட்டின் பிரதிநிதியாக ஆஸ்திரேலியாவுக்கு வருகை தந்தது எமக்கு மிகவும் பெருமை அளிக்கின்றது. உங்களது பரந்த அறிவு, நிர்வாக திறமை, சேவை மனப்பான்மை, கருணை, கண்ணியம், சமூக நலம் உணர்வு போன்ற சிறந்த ஆற்றல்களால் நீங்கள் இந்த உயர் பதவியை அடைந்திருக்கிறீர்கள். உங்கள் தலைமையில் இலங்கையில் வடக்கிலே, அதாவது வன்னியில் இயங்கும் ஒரு பானை என்னும் திட்டத்தின் கீழ் உள்நாட்டு போரினால் பாதிக்கப்பட்ட பிரதேசங்களில் உள்ள 33,000 பாடசாலை சிறார்களுக்கு தினசரி சத்துணவு வழங்கப்படுகிறது மற்றும் போரினால் செவிப்புலன் பாதிக்கப்பட்டு சிறுவர்களுக்கு கல்வி புகட்டும் திட்டம் ஒன்றையும் நீங்கள் நடத்தி வருகின்றீர்கள் என்பதையும் நாம் அறிவோம். இவை நமது தமிழ் சமூகத்தின் மேம்பாட்டில் நீங்கள் கொண்டுள்ள ஈடுபாட்டினை தெளிவாக வெளிப்படுத்துகிறது. தமிழ் மூத்த பிரஜைகள் சங்கத்தின் தலைவரான எனக்கு இத்தருணத்தில் ஒரு முக்கிய கடமை உண்டு. எமது சங்கத்தின் சார்பில் நான் சில விடயங்களை உங்கள் முன் சமர்ப்பிக்க விரும்புகிறேன். எமது சங்க அங்கத்தவர்கள் அனைவரும் இலங்கையில் உள்ள எமது தமிழ் மக்கள் இன்று எதிர்நோக்கும் பல்வேறு பிரச்சனைகள் பற்றி மிகவும் விசனமடைந்துள்ளனர். நீண்டகாலம் உள்நாட்டு போரினால் எமது மக்கள் பல்வேறு பிரச்சனைகளுக்கு மத்தியில் வாழ்ந்து கொண்டிருக்கிறார். வடக்கிலும் கிழக்கிலும் காணி பிரச்சனை, மீள்குடியேற்ற பிரச்சனை, இராணுவ பிரசன்னம், மீன்பிடி தொழில் பறிக்கப்பட்டுள்ளது, சிறைச்சாலைகளில் நீண்டகாலமாக விசாரணை என்று வாடும் தமிழ் கைதிகள் போன்றவற்றால் ஒரு நம்பிக்கையற்ற வாழ்க்கை வாழ்ந்து கொண்டிருக்கிறார்கள். நல்லாட்சி அரசாங்கம் விரைவில் இப்பிரச்சனைகளுக்கு தீர்வு தேடித்தரும் என நம்புகிறார்கள். நீண்டகால யுத்தத்தில் எழுந்துள்ள சமூக பொருளாதார பிரச்சனைகளுக்கு குறுகிய காலத்தில் தீர்வு காண முடியாதென்பதை நாம் அனைவரையும் அறிவோம். எனினும் எமது மக்களின் பிரச்சனைகளுக்கு இயலுமான விரைவில் தீர்வு கண்டு அவர்களின் எதிர்காலம் சுபிட்சமாக வாழ்வதற்கு தார்மீக ரீதியில் அரசாங்கம் செயற்பட வேண்டும் என்பதையே ஆஸ்திரேலியாவில் வாழும் தமிழ் மக்களாகிய நாம் நம்பிக்கையுடன் எதிர்பார்க்கும் என்பதை இலங்கை பிரதிநிதியாகிய நீங்கள் அரசாங்கத்திற்கு ஆணித்தரமாக தெரியப்படுத்த வேண்டும் என எமது சங்கத்தின் சார்பில் வேண்டுகோள் விடுக்கிறேன். இறுதியாக எங்கள் அழைப்பினை ஏற்று இவ்விழாவிற்கு வருகை தந்து எம்மை கௌரவித்தமைக்கு எங்கள் சங்கத்தின் சார்பிலே உங்கள் எல்லோருக்கும் நன்றி கூறி நான் விடைபெறுகிறேன். வணக்கம்.
Thank you, Mr. Suntheralingam, for that inspiring speech, the President's speech. He has given His Excellency S. Skandakumar, our chief guest today, the High Commissioner of Sri Lanka, an excellent introduction. I need not say anything further when I call upon His Excellency, Mr. S. Skandakumar.
Honourable Members of Parliament, Your Worship, the Mayor, and very distinguished guests at the head table, President and members of the Committee of the Tamil Senior Citizens Association of New South Wales. On behalf of my colleague, Lal Bikramathunga, I'd like to thank you, sir, the President and his committee, for the kind invitation extended to me and Lal to be here this morning to be part of a very prestigious celebration revolving around 25 years of yeoman service, not just amongst your own members, but even beyond, through your generosity, your compassion, and your love, and therefore a landmark worth celebrating. I do not wish to add to the accolades that have already been paid to you. The very presence of these very distinguished officials representing the Parliament of New South Wales and the Worship himself is an indication of the esteem in which the association is held. And for that reason, it is a singular pleasure and an honour for me and Mr. Bikramathunga to be with you today. And once again, thank you, sir, for the invitation. Listening to that beautiful rendering of the blessing of the Tamil language, as it were, reminded me of my early days in Colombo. In Colombo 4, I don't know how many of you lived in Colombo. And as a young student, I was passionately fond of Tamil films. And whenever I was able to collect 1 rupee and 10 cents, I would then walk down to the Plaza Theatre, which was very famous for the Indian Tamil films, as it were, and sneak into the second class and watch whatever films I could. And today I was reminded of one particular film that I saw. Its name was Thiruvilayadal. And in that, Suntheralingam rendered a beautiful song, 2 lines of which came back to my mind. And I hope I repeat them as they were sung. The first was, it went like this. Yam arinda molihalile, Tamil molipol inidanadu engum kaanum. And the second was, Yam aninda pulavarhalile, Kambanai pol, Valluvar pol, Ilangovai pol, Pumidanil yanganum purandarille. And when you look back on those words and see what poet Bharati had in mind when he said that, and it was so beautifully sung by Suntheralingam, today you have every reason to be proud, as I am, to be who we are. And so once again, thank you for inviting us. Mr. President, you touched on issues that are as close to my heart as it is to the Consul General. Neither of us are career diplomats. We are here with a purpose. It is not the prestige of the position that makes us what we are here today. It is the sense of duty, because we have lived through all that you have experienced throughout your life, some of which were the ones that made you come out seeking greener pastures in a country away from your country of birth. We've seen through the 56 language issue. We were there for the 58 riots. We saw the southern insurrection of the youth in the early 70s. We were there for the second insurrection in the north, again of the youth, as it were. It was unfortunate that governments of that time failed to address the needs of the youth, as it were, because most countries regard the youth as their future generation. We looked at it differently. And then it all escalated through the horrendous incidents of 83 July, from which we never really got back. And that was followed by a brutal 27-year conflict. And that conflict has left behind scars on both sides of the divide that are going to take more than a lifetime to heal. So it is for that reason that if the progress of reconciliation and peace has taken a little longer than what His Excellency the President would have desired when he took office in January of last year, It is these sensitivities that are holding back what he would ideally like to achieve in a much quicker space of time. It was only in 2008 that the indigenous people of Australia were rendered an apology by the government of Australia under Prime Minister Kevin Rudd's time. And you only have to read the text of that apology to be able to understand the extent of the remorse. Notwithstanding that, 8 years have gone by, and I don't think any of these distinguished members would honestly say that all those problems have been resolved. And it is for that reason that I appeal to you for a little more patience. Because when His Excellency took office on the 9th of January 2015 as president, the first thing he did, which I doubt any other head of state has ever done, was to dilute voluntarily his executive powers, because he wanted to make himself accountable both to Parliament and to his people. He then went on in his address to the nation that this day forward, each one of us is a Sri Lankan first, and then we will respect each other's ethnicities. And when he made that statement, my mind went back to the day that Lee Kuan Yew spoke to the Singaporean people when they were granted independence in 1965. This is what he said. He said, "Today we have the right of self-rule. You are free to speak in Mandarin, in Tamil, in English, or in Malay, but never forget that you are first a Singaporean." And that is exactly the sentiments that His Excellency, the President Maithripala Sirisena, echoed, unfortunately, 67 years after independence, whereas Lee Kuan Yew said it on the very day of independence. And don't forget that he looked to Ceylon, as it were, as a model for his own country. And look at Singapore's progress in the next 50 years and relate that to ours. And I don't think I need to say more. So, ladies and gentlemen, in demonstration of his commitment to that genuine process for peace and reconciliation, on the 4th of February last year, His Excellency the President moved a declaration of peace where respect was paid to every life that was lost both in the conflict and in violence since independence. He then moved amendments to ensure that the independence of the judiciary, the public service, and the police, so that there would be an arm's length relationship between the executive and those very vital institutions. He appointed a constitutional council to make sure that the appointments were fair, just, and credible. And then with the Prime Minister, he moved a national unity government between the two major parties in our country, and the leader of opposition became the head of the Tamil National Alliance. So there is participation in the decision-making process. Time went by, and then he moved the Right to Information Bill, which was carried in Parliament, and most recently, it was the right to set up an office for missing persons. In addition to that, the former president of our country, the Chandakumar Tunga, heads a secretariat for peace and reconciliation. So ladies and gentlemen, all I'm trying to tell you is that every step has been taken by His Excellency the President. I grant that there has been the speed of achievement in relation to the commitments made has been slower than we would have liked, slower than what he would have liked. But there are reasons for that. Because it is only between January of last year and August of today that all these positive steps have been taken. Sometimes we have a tendency to reflect on the time that the conflict ended in 2009 and expect the progress and relate the progress since then. But the genuine commitment to peace and reconciliation was made only in January of last year. And we all know that the path to that reconciliation is not an easy one, because for reasons I've already told you, there are scars on both sides of the divide that are probably never going to heal, some of them, because so brutal have been the experiences and so traumatic has been what has transpired. So we need to be a little more patient. But what you can be assured of is the sincerity of this government to move towards that objective. And for that, I would ask you both for your patience and assistance, because the role that you can play is to spread that word of togetherness, that we are no longer, we are all people with Sri Lankan heritage. Admittedly, you have now come to this beautiful country of Australia. You know what multicultural harmony can do for the well-being of a country. There's no finer example of that than Australia itself. And I know that you still love your country of birth, no matter what your experiences have been. And to that commitment, I hope that you will spread this word in your work that you're already doing, expand it, so that near 200,000 Sri Lankans who are living now in Australia can also come together to support the government in what they have committed themselves to and the noble objectives of peace for all. We are predominantly a Buddhist country, and we grant that. And it was 2,600 years ago where Lord Buddha preached, and the concluding line in every one of his sermons was the Sanskrit Loka Samasta Sukhino Bhavantu, which actually meant, may all beings be happy. And you know, 2,600 years later, we ask ourselves the question, to what extent have those noble words actually been followed? Education gives us knowledge, but it must not be confined to knowledge alone. It must also give us wisdom. The wisdom to realize that none of us have a choice over how we come into this world. The wisdom to realize that when God calls time on our lives, we will live it only with our conscience. So we come in as equals and we leave it as equals. And why is it that we choose to treat the interim unequally? We all live our lives hoping that we can rest in peace. And I ask myself the question, why in heaven's name don't we use our resources to live in peace? And these are some of the questions I'm not posing to you, because I know that you have been discriminated against, and that's why you came out here. But I ask this question of everyone I meet, that why don't we show more love, more compassion to each other, knowing, to quote Warren Buffett, the American billionaire, birth is an ovarian lottery. And that basically means that some of us are born into circumstances much more fortunate than others. But that puts on the lottery winners an overwhelming responsibility to share that relative well-being with people less fortunate than themselves. So much so that the only time that any one of us will look down on a fellow human being would be when we give him our hand to raise him up. So ladies and gentlemen, thank you again for this invitation. And I feel honored to be here given all what that you have achieved over the 25 years. And much as language divided us in 1956, may I ask that we adopt a new language collectively based on what you have already contributed, the language of compassion. Because that is the language, as Mark Twain once said, that helps the blind to see and the deaf to hear. Thank you, and may God bless you all.
Thank you, Your Excellency. I'm sure you would all agree that we understand now why he has been appointed the High Commissioner for Sri Lanka. With